Good evening, everyone. We are live from London at Picturehouse Central, and we're also live in over 300 cinemas across the UK for a very special evening indeed, because tonight we are being joined by Al Gore to discuss his new documentary, An Inconvenient Sequel, Truth to Power, the highly anticipated follow-up to the Oscar-winning documentary that basically brought climate change to the forefront of popular culture. And tonight we want to hear from you. So if you have a question for the former vice president, or indeed if you have a comment, if you want to make your voice heard this evening, you can by using the hashtag Ask Al Gore. So please do get your questions and your comments in. And now it is my absolute honor and great pleasure to welcome to the stage former vice president Al Gore.
Thank you, Liz.
Welcome. Such an honor. Thank you for joining us this evening.
Thank you, ladies and gentlemen.
We have so many questions to ask you. I'm going to get started straight away. First, can I ask you, you know, following the first film, the first documentary 10 years ago now, how did you feel about the response that it received?
I was really happy about the reaction to the first movie. And though it's not for me to say, so many people around the world made very generous comments about the impact they felt it had, including a great many people who come up to me and say the most amazing things about the impact it had on their own lives. So I was very grateful, and I want to give the honor to Davis Guggenheim, the director of that movie, who won the Oscar for that movie. And also Participant Media, which produces so many amazing movies, documentary and narrative movies. And I want to acknowledge one of the producers of this new movie who is here, Diane Wireman, who is in charge of documentaries at Participant Media, who is also here, and David Lindy, the CEO of Participant Media. We have for this new movie a woman producer and a woman director, so that's a good thing.
Indeed.
There's a new book coming out about women in film called Backwards and in Heels. But also the other director, Bonni Cohen and John Shenk, are responsible for the movie you all are going to see. And the other producers, Richard Burge, and Jeff Skoll heads up Participant Media, and I want to honor him. The big changes in the last 10 years, the last decade since the first movie, are number one, the climate-related extreme weather events are far more numerous and more serious. Number two, we have the solutions now. They were visible at the time of the first movie, but they were on the horizon, and you had to rely on technology experts to assure you that they'll be here. Just wait, they'll be here. But now they're here, and the cost of electricity from solar and wind has dropped so dramatically and continues to go down. In many regions of the world, it's now cheaper than energy from fossil fuels. In some areas, it's less than half the cost. And soon, because of the continuing declines in price, it will be cheaper almost everywhere in the world. So those two changes convinced us that the 10-year mark was a good time to come back and ask audiences for permission to tell what's new. And may I also acknowledge the audiences in the other 300 plus theaters throughout the UK and Ireland. Thank you very much for coming to the theaters. Glad to be here at Picturehouse Central. And by the way, one of the participants in the movie, Lord Nicholas Stern, is here in the audience at Picturehouse Central. And I wanted to acknowledge his fantastic work. He's one of the heroes of the climate movement.
Part of the remit, part of the ambition with this new documentary is to get people involved. So in that vein, we have a question already for you. This is from Angela Fenzi, who asked, how do we reach the masses and how do we engage more people in the climate conversation? Well, I presume this documentary will go a long way towards that.
Well, I certainly hope it does. The first movie added to the momentum of the climate movement, and it is our fervent hope that this one will add another burst of momentum. First of all, learn about the crisis. It is by far the most serious challenge that is faced by humanity today. And then use your voice to win the conversations on climate. All of the great social revolutions, whether women's suffrage or before that abolition or the civil rights movement in my country, anti-apartheid movement globally and in South Africa, and more recently the gay rights movement, all of these movements gained momentum because millions of conversations turned the tide for people who realized that really the central choice is between right and wrong. And since the future of humanity is at risk here, it's rather obvious what the right choice is. And get involved passionately. Use your vote and your privileges as a citizen of whatever country you're in. Let the elected officials know that you want them to do the right thing, you want them to move faster and more boldly, and that you feel passionately about it. The influence of big money in politics is a problem not only in my country, but in many countries. But when enough individuals get together and passionately argue this case, democracies can once again be of, by, and for the people.
So this is about every individual getting involved, particularly considering the resistance that you met after the first film and the resistance that you met again after this documentary. And when you think about the overwhelming evidence, the effects of the climate crisis that you can see with your own eyes now, the things that you have seen,
yeah.
How do you reconcile that? How do you work towards still working with the policymakers and decision makers and yet get us all involved more than ever?
Mm. Well, there's an old saying in the state of Tennessee in the American South where I grew up that if you see a turtle on top of a fence post, you can be pretty sure it didn't get there by itself. And when you see persistent levels of climate denial, almost uniquely in the U.S. and to a lesser extent here in the U.K., you can be pretty sure that didn't happen by itself either. The large carbon polluters made a very cynical decision, this has all been thoroughly documented, to take the blueprint drafted by the tobacco companies years ago, and I'm sure you know the story, when the medical consensus was formed linking the smoking of cigarettes to lung cancer and other diseases. The tobacco companies hired actors and dressed them up as doctors, put them in front of cameras to falsely reassure people that there were no health problems associated with cigarettes, and 100 million people died. The carbon polluters, having many of them, first of all, investigated the climate crisis and privately come to the firm conclusion that, yes, it is real. A Pulitzer Prize was won last year by publications in the U.S. Inside Climate News, the L.A. Times, for documenting this, they knew thoroughly. But then they decided in their public-facing statements to give vast financial support to set up a new cottage industry of climate denial. And they hired many of the same PR agents that had done the evil work of the tobacco companies, and they set about putting pseudoscience into the public stream of discourse in order to try to confuse people into thinking that the scientists had not really arrived at a conclusion, or even arguing that the scientists are greedy and evil, making the science up. And they continue to do this. Now, people are seeing through it in much larger percentages now because there's a new participant in the discussion, Mother Nature. And Mother Nature's voice turns out to be more persuasive than any of us can be. These extreme events, I mean, just earlier this week in part of the UK, there was another one of these rain bombs connected to the climate crisis. You know, 90% plus of the heat energy trapped is going into the oceans, so the water vapor coming into the skies and transported over the land is fueling these record downpours. You've had a bunch of them in the UK in the last few years, with homes underwater for weeks on end in some cases. And just earlier this week, there was a month's worth of rain in one day. This past week in my country, the cities of both Miami and New Orleans were flooded out and paralyzed by rain bombs, 7 inches in 2 hours in Miami, 9 inches in 12 hours in New Orleans. And the droughts in many areas last week, the fires across southern Europe and the heat wave, they gave a name, Lucifer, and the tropical diseases moving northward and the ice melting and raising sea level. These things are penetrating this effort by the carbon polluters to confuse people. They're doing it because they claim a right to use the sky as an open sewer for free, as long as they want, to extend for more decades the squeezing of profits out of activities that are threatening the future of humanity. Deeply unethical, deeply immoral. We have to rise up as individuals, as a voice from the grassroots, to call out this activity and to insist that we not only change things like light bulbs, but that we change laws and policies. And the historic breakthrough in Paris a year and a half ago is a cause of wonderful hope, and I'm sure we'll discuss that more.
We will indeed. Excellent answer. Along with the more challenging things that each of us can do as individuals. At Obviously Vegan asks, should people consider their diets when it comes to reducing our impact on the environment?
Yes, but I will confess to you, Liz, I'm not usually timid. I am a little timid in trying to proselytize for people, to encourage people to make the different diet choices. I personally became a vegan 5 years ago. I did it to see what it was like for a month, and I felt better. And by the way, your doctors will say eat less red meat for your own good health. Agriculture as a whole is responsible for about 15% of the causes of the climate crisis, according to the scientists. And within agriculture, animal agriculture is an outsized cause, because it takes about 8 pounds of plant protein to produce 1 pound of animal protein. So this is a significant issue. And maybe I should be more forward-leaning in talking about diet, but I know people who really like steaks and cheeseburgers, and I was in Germany last week. I didn't want to take on the sausage industry, but since you've called me out with your question, I will say yes, that's part of the problem.
Let's discuss a little bit more about the Paris, the momentous climate change conference in 2015. A lot of people said, you know, we had reached a tipping point. Many people said we'd actually passed it. What was the mood like there? What was the energy like there when you arrived and throughout the conference?
It was amazing. First of all, former President Hollande of France and Laurent Fabius, the foreign minister who chaired the conference, and Christiana Figueres, who ran the conference for the UN, and many others are the real heroes of that conference. Nick Stern and I were there, along with many others, trying to help things along. And I was honored to be asked by Fabius and Hollande and Figueres to help play a role there. The mood was affected profoundly by the terrorist attack that happened 2 weeks before the conference opened. And some French politicians said we should cancel the conference, but Hollande said, no, we're going forward. And there were 195 countries, 150 heads of state came. Every single one of them began their speeches with condolences to the French people, admiration for their resolve and going forward in spite of the tragedy, and then an expression of how great the opportunity was in the sobering moment after that tragedy to say, okay, we have got to do the right thing here. And so the mood was quite impressive. And they changed the script. And in the past, the national leaders spoke at the end. They had the national leaders come at the beginning to make their high-level commitments, and that kept their underlings and negotiators from holding out to the last minute. So it was really an amazing success, and it was an historic breakthrough, not only because of the commitments of virtually every nation in the world to get to net zero global warming pollution by mid-century, but also because it was designed from the start to send a powerful signal to investors, to industry, to business, to civil society. The train was leaving the station. Are you on or off? And now the entire world is committed, and there have been profound changes since that conference. And I won't go through them, but India just announced after Trump's speech that within only 13 years, they're requiring that 100% of the new cars and trucks be electric vehicles. No more internal combustion engines, diesel, or that's 10 years sooner than the UK is doing it. And I don't know how much sooner than my country is doing it, so I have no room to speak. But this is one of many, many changes that have come in the wake of Paris.
So many other eye-opening moments of which you were part of that you will see in the film after this fantastic stuff. And in that vein, of course, it leads me to asking you where we stand now with respect to the withdrawal of the Trump administration in the agreement. And Chantelle Thompson asks, how much harder has Donald Trump made it for you to deliver the message on climate change?
Great question. And I myself feared when he made that statement that it might do a lot of damage. I feared specifically that some other countries, and I had a few in mind, might use his decision as an excuse to pull out of the agreement themselves. But the exact opposite happened. The very next day, the entire rest of the world redoubled their commitment to the Paris Agreement, as if to say, we'll show you, Donald Trump. And in my country, the governors of our largest states, hundreds of mayors of cities, thousands of leaders in business, all stepped up to fill the gap and say, we are still in the Paris Agreement. And as a result, it now looks as if the U.S. will keep its commitments under the Paris Agreement in spite of what Donald Trump tweets. And the first legal date on which the U.S. could actually leave the Paris Agreement, not entirely coincidentally, is actually the day after the next presidential election in 2020. A new.
What do you mean by that, Mr. Gore?
Yeah, a new president.
Shall we all pray together?
Then or sooner, could simply give 30 days notice and rejoin the agreement.
Ooh, that's an exciting prospect, isn't it? We have so many questions coming in.
Yeah.
I do want to involve our viewers as much as we can. So, Helen Sanders asks, what can schools and children like my son Leo do to not make the same mistakes as our generation?
Great question. All these great social revolutions have featured an exceptionally prominent role for young people with the energy and the passion, and of course, they're often less encumbered by the barnacles of misconception that some of us grow again over the years. The civil rights movement in my youth was certainly that way. Learn about it is the first thing, and this movie is a great way to do that. Take others to it, and then speak up. Young people in the civil rights movement actually engaged their parents and elders in conversations that featured pointed questions. Why is it legal to discriminate on the basis of skin color? And when their parents could not answer those questions, it contributed to the changing of the laws. Why, they might ask, are we using the sky as an open sewer, even though you know that it threatens my future? If those questions are asked by young people, and if they go farther and organize, then this can make a profound difference. And don't forget also that you have the opportunity, while young, to choose what skills and knowledge to acquire if you really want to be a part of the solutions here. I remember when I was 13 years old hearing President John F. Kennedy make the inspiring pledge to put a person on the moon and bring him back in 10 years, and I heard some older people say, oh, it's a waste of money, it's unwise, we probably won't be able to do it anyway. But 8 years and 2 months later, Neil Armstrong set foot on the moon. And in Houston, Texas, at NASA's Mission Control, there was a great cheer that went up. The average age of the systems engineers at Mission Control in that room was 26, which means, among other things, their average age when they heard that challenge was 18. They decided on a course of study and skill acquisition that will enable them to have the privilege of joining and achieving that mission. A lot of young people today are deciding that they want to be a part of solving this crisis.
Indeed. Speaking about, you know, the climate change agreement in Paris and Trump's withdrawal, just, you know, going back to that, and it's a question that I wanted to ask you, just having seen the movie a couple of days ago, which put such a fire in my belly, I can't wait for you all to see it. This is a question from Darren Hall that mirrors mine. How do you stay so positive, considering big setbacks like the Trump administration withdrawing, and setbacks all the time, the climate change deniers having their say still? How do you maintain the hope, maintain the positivity, maintain the energy, and how do you stay positive?
I'm inspired by the millions of grassroots activists around the world who are the real heroes of this climate movement. They're doing the most extraordinary things. I have trainings all around the world. I'll tell you a quick story. At one of my recent trainings in the U.S. in Denver, Colorado, an 11-year-old girl came. And I said to my staff, are we sure, is she old enough to do this? I felt like the owner of an amusement park that said, you have to be taller than this bar to ride. But she took copious notes for 3 days. 2 weeks later, I clicked on a video that was going viral on the internet, and here's the same 11-year-old girl going to the town hall meeting of her Republican congressman, standing up, getting the microphone, and just giving him hell on climate. And I thought, you go, girl. So I really am inspired by the people who are out there really working hard. And we don't have time for despair. Is just another form of denial. We've got work to do. The stakes are too high. And what a privilege it is to be alive in a moment when we together can decide whether or not human civilization has a bright and prosperous, healthy future, or alternatively, if we made the wrong decision, condemn future generations to consequences too horrible to imagine. So how could anyone who is seized of the urgency of solving this crisis feel tired? I get my energy from the mission itself, from the work, and from those who are out there doing it every day.
And with respect to this film, a decade after the first one, is it more of a call to arms in that regard? And Martin Hayfield asks, do you think this film will be the film that changes the world?
Well, I hope very much that it has a positive and powerful impact on those who see it. And by the way, to all of you here and to all of you in the 340 other theaters and throughout the UK and Ireland who are watching right now, one of the things that you can do, if you're willing to do it, if you like this movie and feel it's worthwhile, what matters most in recommending movies today in this noisy media environment is what people hear from friends and people they know word of mouth, and social media. If after seeing this you think that it is important for others to see it, please consider spreading the word. The more people who see this movie, the more momentum the climate movement will gain. And environmental NGOs are organizing around this movie in the UK, in the US, and in other countries. It's going to be in 40 to 50 countries around the world, and we want it to add to that momentum. So I hope it will.
Do keep your questions coming in. We've gotten some fantastic questions so far. Remember to include the hashtag AskAlGore. At DocsFactor wants to know, what is the one behavior you want people to urgently change?
Get involved in trying to influence the people who are elected to represent you. It's important to make the changes in the technologies you use, the products you buy, and all of that. But it's more important to change the laws and the policies. And even though many democracies, including my own, have been hacked by big money, even before Putin hacked American democracy, nevertheless, when people use strength in numbers, when you reach out with passion to collect others who agree with you and petition or speak or write in any way, contact to influence those who represent you and candidates asking for your support. That's how change can take place powerfully. The UK is at risk of not meeting its agreement, its commitments under the Paris Agreement. I don't want to meddle in your
Meddle away, please.
Yeah, yeah.
Please.
But I started to say I have enough to deal with in the U.S.
We need
the difference between what your government does and what it fails to do can come down to how much they hear from the people. And there has to be a powerful expression to overbalance the lobbyists who are out there. They do claim the right to use the sky as their open sewer for free indefinitely, no matter the consequences for the rest of us. And that has to stop. But the only way it will stop sooner rather than later, stop in time to avoid the catastrophic consequences the scientists have been warning us about, is if enough people at the grassroots take the time and expend the energy and express the passion to let them know it is important to you. That's the main thing.
Let's talk about some more positive aspects of your journey, your 40-year journey, this passion for the environment that you've had. M. Cooksey wants to know, what do you think the most viable alternative to fossil fuels is? What excites you the most? What do you think is the most promising alternative?
I personally am most excited about the advances in solar energy. The cost has come down so quickly, it's quite incredible. There have been 3 contracts signed in different parts of the world in the last couple of months, in Abu Dhabi, in Chile, and in Arizona in the U.S., where unsubsidized electricity is contracted for at a rate less than half of the cost of electricity from burning fossil fuels. And that is a sign of things to come in more and more regions around the world. Wind is also the cheapest electricity source in the UK right now. The UK already gets more electricity from wind than from coal. And by the way, in the US, and I know it's true in many other places, but in the US right now, solar jobs are growing 17 times faster than other jobs in the economy. The single fastest growing job is wind turbine technician. So we face an economic challenge in the world of weak secular demand. We need a global project to put millions of people to work. We have a project. We need to convert to renewable energy, electric vehicles, battery technology, sustainable agriculture, sustainable forestry, sustainable fishing. We can do it. We need to retrofit buildings, residential, commercial, and industrial, to ways to stop the waste of energy, which is 25% of the problem. And all of those things create jobs that can't be outsourced to other countries because they're in every community. So we can solve this crisis and strengthen our sustainable economy at the same time. Look, we are in the early stages of a global sustainability revolution. It has the magnitude of the Industrial Revolution, but the speed of the digital revolution. The scientists and engineers are giving us the ability to manage molecules and atoms comparable to what we learned in the information sector about how to manage bits of information. And there's a massive retooling of business and industry going on all around the world. And every human endeavor now is becoming far more efficient and less wasteful, producing less emissions that contribute to this crisis. And this is also the biggest commercial and business opportunity in the history of human civilization. So we need to get on with it. We can solve multiple problems at the same time.
We touched on this when you mentioned India, and certainly what you will see in the documentary about the negotiations you took part in were fascinating. Francis Pimenta asks, how confident are you about the potential for low-income countries to leapfrog to low-carbon technologies? Mm. They do have this argument that, right, as developed countries, we have had our way and had our heyday. It's their turn to fast-track to that level with fossil fuels, and then they'll be ready for renewables. That simply isn't acceptable anymore, is it?
Well, the analogy between their situation now and the situation of the United Kingdom and North America and Europe 150 years ago, the analogy is not quite exact, because if 150 years ago we had available to us these exciting new technologies of the 21st century that didn't pollute our cities and make our air unbreathable and cause so many deaths, we would have chosen the clean energy back then. And right now, there is a kind of a political crisis in some parts of countries like China and India as the new members of the middle class there become more aware of how many deaths are caused by the choking air pollution. And there is pressure to cut the co-pollutants that also come with the global warming pollution. And the analogy you will see to cell phones. You know, we have this elaborate landline telephone technology. I don't know about you, but I don't even answer my landline telephone anymore because it's always a telemarketer. And I've got my iPhone with me. If we could leapfrog, we would. They have that opportunity, and they are doing it. The same is true for energy systems. There are as many people in India who have no electricity at all as almost the entire population of the United States of America. Are they really going to recreate the old, outdated electricity infrastructure that we relied on for so long? We wouldn't if we were doing it again. We would do the decentralized, distributed energy systems that make more sense economically as well as environmentally. So they are making this choice, and you will see some examples in the movie. It's very, very exciting. There are many countries in the developing regions that are just really going all out to install solar panels and take advantage of it.
We're nearly out of time, can you believe it? But I want to ask you one more question.
All right.
This is from @WeAreTea, and she asks, do you look forward to the future for you and your family? And may I just add as well, what would be the one message you would like to leave with our viewers?
I do look forward to the future. I have four children. I have four grandchildren. I have a fifth on the way, a fifth grandchild on the way. I really connect my own passion for the impact this is potentially going to have on the next generation to those I know and love so deeply. And And I'm very positive and optimistic. But my optimism, I must tell you, is premised on the assumption that the movement we now have to solve this climate crisis will continue and will build and will grow. I believe it will. A famous economist, now deceased Rudy Dornbusch, once said, things take longer to happen than you think they will, and then they happen much faster than you thought they could. We've seen that in other movements. If somebody had told me, even 5 years ago, that in the year 2017, gay marriage would be fully legal in all 50 U.S. states, accepted, honored, and celebrated by two-thirds of the American people, I would have said, well, I sure hope so, but I think you're being wildly unrealistic and naive. But it happened because the conversation was won, because brave gay and lesbian people decided to express who they were, and their friends and coworkers said, oh, really? Oh, okay, I get it now. And people decided en masse, if God created people this way or that way, God could not have intended they'd be persecuted for the rest of their lives. And what the hell does it matter who, what kind of person you fall in love with? Let's get on with it and come together. That's an example of things taking a long time, but then changing suddenly. And the climate movement is right at that tipping point right now.
And you will certainly feel it when you watch this documentary. If you want to be part of the conversation after you watch this film this evening, please join in with the hashtag #BeInconvenient and lots of information on the website to just fire you up and get you involved in the same way that I want to be involved after watching it. It's time to watch the most important documentary you will see this year. All that is left for me to do is to thank you so much for joining
thank
us,
you,
for
Liz.
Taking the time. We know your time. You're a very busy man. And to thank you again for your continued passion and dedication in fighting for the planet. Ladies and gentlemen, the former Vice President,
thank
Al Gore.
You. Thank you. Thank you, Liz. Thank you so much. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you very much.